I wonder if it's my laptop too.
Could be me. You know, you're kind of pixelated. It's not the end of the world, you know. Like if it's pixelated, we have lo-fi on our channel, so if you don't mind,
if it's pixelated, that would suck. But
I don't know. Maybe you look better. Like who knows? Maybe it's actually an improvement. You know. Hello, insiders. Today we have a very exciting, video. Tom started a series called Interviewing My Boss, and I was the first boss that he interviewed. And we thought that went well. So now we're going to take it up a level, and I'm going to try to interview my boss. And I'm Ariel, as you may recall, and I'm responsible for Creator Products, which is a part of YouTube. And I have the pleasure of talking to my boss, Neil Mohan, who's the Chief Product Officer at YouTube. So he's responsible for all products at YouTube. So, hey, Neil, how are you?
Hey, Ariel. Nice to be with you. Glad to join you in front of the camera.
Yeah, and we'll see how pixelated you are. Maybe, you know, we have low standards on this channel, but we'll see how this plays out. Okay. So thank you for humoring us. Let's start. Just tell us a little bit about you. Where are you from, et cetera?
I grew up mostly in the Midwest, in Michigan, of all places. I lived kind of all over the place, Michigan, Florida. I actually spent a few years in India during high school, believe it or not. And then I came back to the States, to California for college. And I've been at Google, as you know, actually almost as long as you, not quite as long as you, but...
I've been 15 and a half years. How long have you been?
I'm not even close then. I've been here for over 12 years. I came to Google when we sold a company called DoubleClick to Google. And for a long time, in fact, most of my time at Google, I was the SVP of Google's display and video ads products. And I came over to YouTube 5 years ago as the head of product. It's been awesome working with all of our amazing creators.
So how do you compare YouTube to ads?
So you know, just as well as I do, that there's a big ads part of YouTube, obviously, that you and I both work on a regular basis. In fact, the primary way that all of our creators generate revenue is through advertising. And so ads is a really big part of YouTube. In fact, the way that I was exposed to YouTube and the way that I worked with YouTube even before coming over as in my current role was through advertising and monetization. What I'd say is a little bit different is getting to work much more closely with all of the amazing creative talent that's out there. And, you know, you obviously experience that every day. I get to as well. And so that's been a really positive aspect of being here at YouTube. And then the other one, of course, is that first and, you know, just as much as YouTube is a product for our creators, it's also a product for our users. And so just, you know, a big part of my job as Chief Product Officer is building features and functionality that our users will love. And we'll make it so that they can connect with all of our creators much more seamlessly, much more effectively as well.
Yeah, which leads me to another question. So now that you've been here 5 years, like, how would you compare the YouTube that you found to the YouTube that you have now? What are the kind of the big differences that you've seen?
Yeah, you know, that's a good question. And I would say that in some sense, lots of things are really still the same, not just in my 5 years, but frankly, I think from everything that I've seen over the entire kind of history of YouTube, which is it's a platform fundamentally about connecting our awesome creators with their audiences and fans around the world. The original mission of YouTube in terms of giving everyone a voice has remained the same and consistent. So I think that that's been really interesting to observe. But lots of aspects have changed. One is, you know, YouTube has continued to grow. Platform that we take in some sense sort of for granted today has grown dramatically in the 5 years that I've been here in terms of the presence of the platform all over the world, ways for creators to connect with fans, not just where they're located, but really all over the world. That aspect of community has continued to grow as we continue to build more products for users to connect with their fans. And then the creativity of our creators, you know, whether it's the sort of the traditional sort of VOD videos that we have on our platform, whether it's things like stories, whether it's the growth of things like live, all of that are really interesting ways for our creators to continue to be more and more creative. So that's been super interesting to see over the last 5 years.
So one of the things that I've seen, and we've worked together a lot on it, is just kind of, I think what you call responsibility. Kind of, for example, in my world, how the monetization program has changed, YPP, our partner program. Can you touch a little bit on kind of your view on YouTube's role from a perspective of responsibility?
Yeah, I mean, I think that the way that I would think about that is, you know, kind of back to what I just said, which is, you know, YouTube is a global platform. It's available to users and to creators all over the world. And that's part of the magic of the platform. You know, you can put your creative idea on the platform and build an audience, including fans that might be on the other side of the world. And 2 billion users come to the platform every single month. And so when you say responsibility, the way I think about it is we do have a responsibility as a global platform. We're not just a reflection of what's happening in the world today. We have an impact on the world. All of the creators have, you know, a profound impact on their audiences, on what's happening in the world. And so one of the parts of my job, I know you view this as a big part of your job, is to make sure that YouTube remains an open platform, but one that is also safe for all of our users, the entire ecosystem, our creators, our users, our advertiser partners, etc. And that's reflected in our community guidelines.
Yeah, and we've been spending a lot of time on it, like you're saying, together, and it's been a really interesting journey. And comparing where we were 5 years ago to where we are today, I think there were like dramatic differences I think creators can see as well.
Yeah, and I mean, I think it's been a, you know, I think, you know, you and I would be, I think, the first people to say that it's been a journey, a learning journey for, certainly for me, you know, hopefully all of our creators recognize this, but there's thousands of employees at YouTube who are really dedicated to this mission of living up as a responsible global platform to protect our users, protect our creators, the vast, vast majority of whom are out there looking to create amazing content, produce great sort of positive energy sort of for the world. And that's the responsibility that we try to live up to every day, is to make sure that they can continue to do that in a safe environment.
Okay, hey, Neil, thanks for coming back. We just for the viewers, we had some Wi-Fi issues, and the sun was getting in the way of the camera, and the quality was even below the Creator Insider standard, which is pretty low. So thank you for moving to a new location. So let's go to the next question. So we are in the middle of a really bad pandemic around the world, COVID or coronavirus, and that's impacted both creators and employees of YouTube. And I'm curious, kind of over the last couple of months, what have you seen, and what do you think creators should be thinking about?
So first of all, obviously, as you know, Ariel, this is impacting not just us here at YouTube, but literally all of humanity all around the world. Been this way, obviously, for several months, and it looks like it will continue for some time. And it's had a profound impact on our entire ecosystem, all of our users and creators and advertisers, of course, but everybody here working at YouTube every day. And in fact, when it was becoming clear that this was going to become a truly global crisis, you know, early on this year in the February, March timeframe, our first responsibility was to really ensure the safety of all of our employees, our extended workforce. And so many of you may have seen the impacts of that when our extended workforce had to go offline. Some of them worked from home, many of them were offline. And that resulted in us moving to much more automated systems to enforce our community guidelines, et cetera. Of course, some people, including many creators, saw the impact of that. That's been ongoing. Hopefully that's gone relatively smoothly, although there's been, you know, upticks and things like false positives, et cetera. But that was one of the immediate impacts of COVID on all of us as employees. I would say the other thing from a user standpoint is that users are thirsty for information around COVID, around coronavirus, to protect their families, their communities. News consumption on our platform is up 75% year on year as people are looking for this information. You've probably seen lots of things that we're doing in the product, from everything from the COVID news shelf that runs as soon as you open up the YouTube app, to information panels that run below videos, linking out to local or regional health authorities to provide the most relevant, useful information to our users. And then even when users are searching for that type of information on YouTube, an information panel that provides, again, that latest information. Because, you know, this one of the unique aspects of this crisis is that, you know, science and knowledge is being created on an hourly or daily basis. And so we want to make sure that our users are getting the most authoritative and relevant information when they're looking for it on YouTube. So that's what I would say is the second big, really big impact. And then the third, of course, is it's been amazing to see our creators really step up. in many ways. First on, you know, early on in the pandemic, it was around encouraging people to shelter in place if they could, to flatten the curve. Live streams where people from all over the world who were dealing with this stress in their own families could come together and you know, consume content all at once. And so we've seen lots of growth in creative uses of live streams, our creators stepping forward to generate donations for worthy causes around COVID, et cetera. And so that's been the third really big impact. And it's been really gratifying to see the amazing work that all of our creators around the world have been doing to help kind of all of humanity deal with this crisis.
Yeah, another aspect that might be interesting is that I've heard from creators in the early days when we were demonetizing videos related to COVID, because we thought of it as a potentially short event, what we call sensitive events, and we just took the position of, you know, let's not monetize these. But once we realized that it's going to be a longer event, and with the help of many creators who gave us strong feedback that they have a role to play in getting that information out, we really modified the policies as well so that we could monetize. So all these activities that you're talking about had to be, we had to change the way we enforced our policies to allow monetization. So let's get into some rapid fire questions. Tom, when he introduced the idea that maybe we'll interview you, asked the audience for questions. And we've been hearing a bunch of topics as well with creators ongoing. So let's start hitting you. You know, Tom likes to say, let's keep it real. So let's hit you with some rapid fire questions and get your thoughts. So the first one is, which is kind of like why we're here, but maybe I don't want to lead the witness. When I joined YouTube, there was a lot of unhappiness from creators about transparency and communication. I'd like to think that we've improved, but, you know, who knows? We'll hear from our audience. But how do you think about communicating with creators?
Yeah, I mean, so, you know, hopefully this, what we're doing right now is one example of that. Creator Insider, I can't remember exactly when it was launched or when, you know, you were sort
of... I launched it. I can't remember exactly. I'm guessing at least 2 years or something, right? Yeah.
Somebody should remember. It should be you. But it's been years and it's grown nicely. And I think that part of the reason is because I do think creators appreciate its attempt at transparency. And so that's certainly one channel. And so feedback around how we can continue to make that better and more useful for our creators is obviously one aspect. I would say that the primary, at least from my standpoint, and I'm biased obviously as the product guy, is studio. And so obviously, you know, Ariel, your team has done a phenomenal job in terms of the new studio. But sort of creating that as a place, almost as a news hub, if you will, for the latest and greatest around what impacts our creators on a regular basis, I think is a vision that we all had early on when we were re-envisioning Studio. And I think you're starting to see that play out, but there's obviously a lot more that can be done there in terms of news flashes, you know, kind of the need to know information that we're providing to users there. And so that's what I would say also. We've picked up the pace on social. So everything from, you know, Team YouTube, all of our other social handles as well. I think our response rates have been improved by something like 50%. We're doing 150% the volume. And so that's another channel that I would encourage all of our creators to make sure that they're plugged into. Those are, you know, some examples of things that we have established and want to continue to grow. But there's obviously lots more work to be done there. And also, like I said at the beginning, if there's feedback on things that we can do to improve that, please, please let us know about that.
Add in the comments below the video and we'll be reading it. And speaking of policies, like how do you think about policies in general at YouTube? What's changed over the years that you've been here? I know that my perspective is that policies really drive our decisions and we don't do one-off decisions, which sometimes can be frustrating for a creator because they don't always understand the context for why the policy is there. But my understanding of the policies is we really use them to balance all the different constituents and come up with a principled approach to how we make decisions. But I'm curious how you see policies and the role at YouTube and how should creators think about policies?
Yeah, I mean, I think the first principle, and I'll just be very, very upfront about this, is we think about our policies from the standpoint that the vast, vast majority of our creators are really trying to do the right thing, to grow their audiences, to grow their business. And our job at YouTube is to really support that fundamental mission. And when we think about our policies, we really do try to look through that lens. How do we stop the very small fraction of bad actors so that the vast majority of creators can continue to do what they do and create the magic of YouTube. And that, I think, is a really important point. And sometimes I think that that gets lost in the day-to-day sort of communications around that when we get into the nitty-gritty. But taking a step back, that really is the big picture. The second aspect, of course, is, and you alluded to this, is really trying to strike that healthy balance in the ecosystem. We write our policies in a way that they can apply equally to everyone on the platform. I think that that's the most fair and just way of doing it. I think one area that, I know I've gotten feedback on, and I know, Ariel, you have too, where I think we can continue to do better is be as clear about those policies as possible, be transparent about them. Because as I said, I think the vast majority of our creators are looking to do the right thing. And I think it's YouTube's responsibility to be as crystal clear about what those policies are so that our creators can continue to do the right thing and produce awesome content.
Okay, so the next topic that comes up a lot with creators, and I'm sure you've heard this in the past, is trending. What is up with trending? There's always a creator who is unhappy about some other creator that they see. It might be that they see videos from a media company or from music versus a YouTube first creator, or there's all kinds of dynamics around trending. How do you think about trending? What's the goal of trending, and what are we doing, if anything, to address the feedback from creators?
Yeah, trending is a really interesting feature. And I think the questions that come up around trending, perhaps the best way to really answer them is to actually go back to the basis of trending in the first place. Like, why did we actually build this feature? And one of the ideas was to create some place where you could go that could work in complement to what users were already seeing in their home feed. And that destination would be something that would be not personalized in the same way that the home feed is, but something that had sort of broader appeal, more general appeal in terms of the type of content that was videos that were shown there and featured there. And so trending has been designed with that in mind, a place where users could go, new users to YouTube, users that were familiar with YouTube, to see videos that had sort of generally broad appeal. And so that's kind of where it started from. And of course, the feedback that you are referring to is something, you've heard, I've heard a lot. And we want to strike the right balance in terms of the broad appeal, as well as a destination that creators can feel is their own and really represents sort of the vibrancy of YouTube. And so we've made a number of changes to the product based on feedback that we've gotten from creators. And one of the ones that I'm excited about is where at least 50% of what we show there are going to be videos that come from YouTube creators. And so I think that that is a win, not just for our YouTube creators, because they will be shown prominently in trending, but also a win for YouTube because it really depicts what YouTube is all about to our users, especially users that may not be as familiar with YouTube as our daily users are. And so that's been a recent change in place. Of course, if you have feedback on that, please provide it in the comments.
Okay, so let's end with a few questions from the comments when Tom asked for a specific question. So let's see, we have a channel called Lola Land, and the question is it true that brand new channels can't get recommended? How much data in terms of views, subs does YouTube need from a brand new channel to start recommending it? And maybe I could also throw in another version of this question, which is like, what would you recommend for new channels?
Yeah, I mean, and you should obviously chime in here as well, because you've obviously thought a lot about this. But I would say that I can give a very long answer on this, but the short answer is no. There's no sort of inherent disadvantage to a new channel there. Fundamentally, it's really about the audience and the performance of the videos vis-a-vis that audience. Every single day, we take in on the order of, something like 80 billion signals, from views and various forms of engagement and feedback, et cetera, to really determine what is best for that user right then and there in terms of their home feed or after they're done watching a video. And we've also done a lot of work to continue to make it so that new videos, new channels are not at a disadvantage. Fresh signals are incorporated on a regular sort of real-time basis there. And so that's work that we have ongoing. And, my overall sort of piece of advice in general is really just focusing on the content of the video, making it something that is true to your passion, you know, authentically, something that comes from you, you know, something that you think will be engaging to the audience that you're looking to reach. And as long as you continue to focus on that, I think all of these other things are really extraneous. That is sort of the most important thing.
Yeah, I would say there's really, it's our job and the algorithm's job is to find that talent, right? So, you know, and we see creators who rise through kind of the size levels and are wildly successful, and they, you know, started a short time ago, a long time ago, et cetera. So I absolutely encourage new creators to really focus on the content. And also with one nuance is try to find something you're passionate about, but also where there's space and there's not 500 other creators doing exactly the same thing. It's kind of like starting a business to some degree, right? You can really find your niche. Okay, so let's see. I think we have time for one more question maybe. How about we go to this question from the big jackpot. Does going live more often help or hurt my channel?
Yeah, so this is something that we're, you know, continuing to look into. I think the short answer there from everything that we know that I know is that it doesn't. We treat live content, video on demand content, the same from a recommendations, from our algorithm standpoint. And, you know, what I would encourage there is, you know, similar to what I just said, which is, if you enjoy producing live content, if you think that's a great way to kind of get your message out, your creativity, connecting with your audience, then I would encourage you to continue to do that. You know, one of the things that we've seen, as I was mentioning earlier, as a result of the COVID pandemic and, you know, many people around the world sheltering at home, is the growth of live content. And we've seen that on our platform. And so if that's something that you enjoy doing and I think is a great way to augment what you're already doing, then I would encourage you to continue to do that.
Hey, Neil, one last thing I forgot to ask you about, and thank you for making more time. Glad I caught you, is just what are you really excited about for the future? If you're a creator, what do you want to hear from our chief product officer and kind of get excited about the future of YouTube?
Yeah, Ariel, I think it really comes down to a lot of the work that your team is leading here. Really two fundamental things on behalf of all of our creators. The first is continuing to build the tools and technology that our creators use every single day to connect with their audiences. You know, the magic of YouTube, as you and I have talked about a lot, is the connection between our amazing creators and all their fans all over the world. So building out capabilities like YouTube posts and stories and other ways for creators and fans to continue to connect. You may have all noticed the work that's gone on in terms of making comments below videos a much more vibrant and relevant and safe community for all of our users and creators. So work like that, I think, is really important and is going to be a top priority for us in the months and years ahead. And then the second big bucket, of course, is once that community is established and a strong connection between creators and fans is established, what are the ways that we can help creators earn a living to produce all that amazing content on a regular basis? So all of our work around things like channel memberships, our work around Super Chat and Super Stickers, ways for creators to earn revenue above and beyond what we, of course, are continuing to do on the advertising side, are also going to remain important priorities so that creators can continue to grow their presence on the platform and establish themselves. As we often talk about, creators are the new media economy. And so what are the things that we can do to support them as companies in this media economy are really big top priorities for us, and where a lot of our resources will continue to be focused in the years ahead.
Yeah, we've talked a lot about, and I know you've challenged us to deliver on it, as like thinking about creators who are creating businesses and have multiple employees, and how do we think about that? And how do we think, for example, about different users? And we've been spending a lot of time on permissions, so you can have, you know, a creator who doesn't see, somebody who can log into studio who cannot see the revenue, for example, but can manage the videos, cannot delete the channel. Like, that's one example, I think, that addresses what you're talking about from the media company perspective. What kind of reporting can we do across channels? We see more and more creators creating multiple channels within their kind of new media company. So we're doing work on that front. How do we become more and more precise in the way we ingest videos and understand the videos so that creators are not surprised in a negative way, right? As they become more and more a business basically and hiring staff, et cetera. So agree with you. This is like a really interesting area for us at YouTube, and we're spending a lot of time on it. We'll see if we can keep you and the creators happy on that front.
Yeah, no, it's great. I think better insights, more relevant insights, and really making them actionable is really key in that regard.
Neil, thanks a lot for your time. We'll see if the audience likes it, even with this low fidelity shooting style that we have on Creator Insider. I hope that if there's a lot of questions and follow up, maybe we'll convince you to come back again.
Thanks for having me. Love being here. Hopefully it's not too pixelated. So let's see how it turns out.
Let's see what people say. And our audience is certainly vocal, so we'll hear back from them. And we have a tradition here where we always quote Tom. Neil, keep it real.
I will try my best.
Thank you.
All right. Take care.